Floor is yours.
May I have your attention, please? There are a few housekeeping announcements. One regards the tonight's vigil service, which is, as you know, the occasion of having the relic of Saint Maximus with us tonight. So vigil service for Saint Maximus the Confessor, his akoulouthia in the theological school chapel will be served. And as you know, his relics from Holy Monastery Agiou Pavlou from Holy Mountain, Greece, are available for veneration. So every priest, anyone who wants to take part to serve, is welcomed, and it's blessed by the Patriarch. That's one thing. And the other thing is about Sundays, going to Kostolac and visiting the monasteries that we mentioned in our letters to you previously. So we want to know who is going, who wished to come. There is a bus, and there are places. Some of the speakers invited are leaving, departing earlier, like Father Manousakis, who is going to be serving here at this university chapel on Sunday. But all of you who are departing Sunday late afternoon or evening, and Monday, Tuesday, are obviously and more than welcome to join us. These two things, I think. If I miss something, I'll come again. Okay. Na srpskom večernja služba, to jest denije, biće služeno u 20:30, pola devet, zavisnosti od toga kako završimo sa diskusijom ovde. Večera će biti posle ovog predavanja, kako sam razumeo, to jest ove sesije, zasedanja, bdenije, dakle služba večernja, jutrenja i liturgije u našoj crkvi. Drugačije nije moglo, s obzirom da imamo mošti svetoga Maksima sa nama. A druga je vest vezana za u nedeljni odlazak i posetu Kostocu, Viminacijumu i manastiru Ravanici. Svi koji žele da, koji su registrovani i žele da idu s nama, neka se jave, bit će spisak gore na stolu za registraciju. So, there will be a list, a paper that when you can sign or cross your name on at the reception desk. Thank you very much.
Now we can proceed with our program, with our fourth session. We have just slight differences in order. The first speaker will be Father John Manousakis, who is Assistant Professor of Philosophy at the College of the Holy Cross and a Honorary Fellow of the Faculty of Theology and Philosophy at the Australian Catholic University. And his research area includes philosophy of religion, phenomenology, ancient Greek philosophy, especially Plato and the Neoplatonic tradition, and patristics. So, Father, you can take the floor, please.
Well, I think His Grace, Bishop Maximus, took my paper that was here. So, together with his papers. So if we can find him and have the paper back, I will be able to read it. No, this is the old one. There is a similar occasion in the Phaedrus where a manuscript is hidden under the clock of Phaedrus and then reappears. So that can be read allegorically too. Before I begin, I would like to thank His Grace, the Bishop of Western America, Bishop Maximus, for the kind invitation to participate to this symposium on St. Maximus. And I would like to thank all of you and all of the people who made that conference possible. Your Eminences, dear brothers in Christ, my original topic was that on the notion of motion. I was planning to talk on kinesis on St. Maximus. But since quite recently, theological controversy unfolds, particularly in Greece, which is localized precisely around the concept and the understanding of the will in St. Maximus, a controversy that implicates two of the most distinguished guest speakers of this conference, namely His Eminence Metropolitan of Pergamon, John, and Professor Christos Giannaras, I decided to address rather the topic of the will, and in particular the topic of the two wills. Therefore, the new title of the paper is the Dialectic of Communion and Otherness in St. Maximus' Understanding of the Will. Recent scholarship on the theology of St. Maximus gives us the following basic frame of the development of his thought on the subject of the will that begins with letter 2 to John Cubicularius and the exposition on the Our Father, written while still in Byzantium, to the works produced during his exile in the West, such as the Ambigua, the Dispute with Pyrrhus, and the Polemical Opuscula, written during the peak of the Monothelite controversy. It is believed that St. Maximus began with two concepts, that of the will and of nature, which he sometimes contrasted to each other in order to refine further his terminology, in order to include two conceptions of the will, one natural, thelema physico, the other associated with one characters or person, thelema gnomico. The crucial question, however, in my opinion, concerns the eschatological destiny of the gnomic will, that is, whether gnomy in general and gnomic will in particular will, in some form, however transform or glorify, survive at the eschata. Will or will not the creaturely character of the creature abide eschatologically? That is, does the created-uncreated distinction still hold at the end of times and in God's kingdom? If we want the Chalcedonian formula to express an eternal truth, as it must. In discussing the relationship of the will to nature, we cannot lose sight of the distinction of this distinction, because the human nature as created does imply constraint, compulsion, and necessity, characteristics that are of course unknown to the divine nature, and therefore one should carefully avoid falling prey to speaking univocally of God's and man's nature, as it is often the case in the monothelitic debates. Depending on how one is prepared to answer the questions we pose above, it can be predicated that what view one will take with regard to gnomic will, if the created-uncreated distinction will be abolished for the sake of some eschatological panentheism, then gnomy and the person are obstacles in this process of deification, and they too must be overcome. If, on the other hand, the distinction somehow still remains, then one cannot dispense with gnomy altogether. In the East, there has always been an emphasis on a strong understanding of deification, but such deification is by grace and not by nature. Yet, does such a strong understanding of the deification of nature mean, in light of the create-uncreated distinction, that human nature, as deified, is eschatologically overcome not only in its fallen, but also in its creaturely character? I will opt for saying that the human nature is perfected, even though its creaturely character remains. That nature as created by God is susceptible to such deification, capax dei, is of course without question. Yet, as created by God, it is also subject to limitations that made impossible for it to reach such a goal by itself, naturally. Otherwise, we're confronted with the dangers of Pelagianism. As created by God, nature has been given both a direction as well as the impetus that will carry towards such goal. It is us, I admit, with our gnomic wheels that keep taking detours away from that aim, delaying the process of our salvation. Yet, I will also say that these long detours and the resistance that they represent on our part against God's plan are somehow instrumental to and even constitutive of our salvation, and that therefore not only our gnomy will not be abolished, but even its history, which is nothing else than history itself, must be upheld and preserved. God, I assume, does not want to save us away from history by some Neoplatonic epistrophe to the One, but to save our history, especially because since the Incarnation, it has been also His history. If this is indeed a fundamental tenet of Christian faith, then God does not come into history in order to save the human nature, but rather in order to save us from the anonymity of our nature. It is important to raise the seemingly obvious question of what is saved. If God does not save the human person, but the human nature as a genus or as an abstraction, then he is not anymore the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, but the God of the Platonic ideas. Another way to say this would be to ask what has fallen, the human nature or the human person. Both questions, however, create an unnecessary and superficial distinction, for it is obvious that it is the human nature that is restored by the salvation of the person, as it was the human nature that was fallen by the sin of a man. Since, for Saint Maximus, the logos of nature is the principle of unity, while will, and especially what he later called gnomic will, is an element of differentiation, distinction, and even division, his eschatological vision of a humanity united not only with itself but also with God seems to suggest the eradication of gnomic will, or at the very least its complete appropriation by nature. So, in his letter 2, he speaks of one nature and one will with God and with one another, a goal that will be achieved when love persuades gnomi to follow nature and not in any way to be at variance with the logos of nature. It was passages like this one that prompt Lars Thunberg to observe that, I quote, "One might get the impression that Maximus was arguing in favor of the idea that the human will should in the end be entirely swallowed up by the divine will. How can we, from within the theological vision of Saint Maximus, maintain a balance between unity and difference, between natural communion and personal otherness?" In St. Maximus' terminology of two wheels, a fundamental experience is reflected, namely the experience of a duality that abides between what I am, my nature, and who I am, my personhood. Between the what, logos της φύσεως, and the who, or the how, τρόπος της υπάρξεως, one should come to recognize what is most abstract and that which is most concrete. In each one of us, two absolutes come together, the universality of nature and the particularity of personhood. Insofar as I am a human being, I am no one and everyone. Everyone, because nature is common, consubstantially common with the humankind, yet no one for humanity cannot assume the position implied and necessitated from him who speaks in the first person. On the other hand, as a person, I'm irreducibly myself, a position uniquely posited and irreplaceably. Between these two absolutes, there is a dialectic relation. If I am myself, that is only insofar as I am a human being, an instantiation of the human nature. Conversely, if there is a human nature, if one can think and speak of such an abstraction, that is only because of a particular person, otherwise human nature would have been an empty concept. The idea of a dialectic relation between nature and self might suggest a certain symmetry. Yet the person is always more than its nature. The person is the surplus of an existence that refuses to be completely identified with its essence. The distance of which we get a glimpse through the ontological difference between existence and existence, the distance between myself and my nature, becomes diminished in those moments where I act only naturally, when I am absorbed to the natural mandates of eating, sleeping, etc. In such moments, life becomes effortless. Incidentally, but not accidentally, these are also the same moments when one becomes less personal and one could argue less human. On the other hand, being oneself becomes invariably a burden that needs to be taken up as one takes up his cross. Being a person, personal being, constitutes and is constituted always by an agony. It is not accidental that St. Maximus' discussions of such a personal will turns always to the exemplar of Christ's agony at the Garden of Gethsemane. Is man meant, either in his alleged prelapsarian paradise or in the eschatological perfection, to be only a natural being? And if so, can we still speak of man as distinct from the animal? Isn't the fall precisely this, the fall from the animal state, or the fall of the animal to humanity, where the sting of consciousness is felt at the moment when their eyes were open and they realized they were naked, as Genesis says? Is humanity the very consciousness whose inception is heralded by the realization of my nakedness, the result of sin, or is sin a possibility only for such a naked and fallen being? Are we to lament, or perhaps to rejoice, over this felix culpa that gave humanity to man even before it gave humanity to God? And isn't this ability to see myself at my sin, the ability to reflect on my sinfulness, the very occasion that sets me on the path to repentance and thus to the ultimate undoing of sin? Man's ability to see himself, the ability to turn his reflective gaze upon himself, as signaled by the line already quoted from Genesis, points at the distance of myself from myself, the distance between the I and the nature that continuously claims it for herself, that is, to the fact of consciousness. The distance or duality that consciousness is, that much is suggested by the very term consciousness, for the prefix con means with, and therefore the sight of consciousness is always a seeing with, appears now as an essential and fundamental human characteristic, so much so that if one could do away with it, he should at the same time get rid of man altogether. Let us now revisit the problematic of the two wills in St. Maximus' work. In the mature articulation of the subject that Opusculum 3 represents, St. Maximus differentiates between two wills by defining natural will only as a possibility, or that is, as an ability that is actualized in the manner of Aristotelian entelechy by a particular someone, a willer, or thelon. In order to elucidate these distinctions, St. Maximus provides an example, that of language, and I quote from the translation of Father Lowth: "To be disposed by nature to will and to will are not the same thing, as is not the same thing to be disposed by nature to speak and to speak. For the capacity for speaking is always naturally there, but one does not always speak, since what belongs to the essence is contained in the principle of the nature, while what belongs to the wish is shaped by the intention, gnomi, of the one who speaks. So being able to speak always belongs to the nature, but how you speak belongs to the hypostasis. So it is with being disposed by nature to will and willing. Even if, at the end of the times, we all will say the same thing, namely, your will be done, as we now all say the Amen in the liturgical prefiguration of the Eschata, that unison does not obliterate difference. For how you speak belongs to the hypostasis, and thus we are allowed to utter our prayers and our amens, not only in our language and idioms, but also with our distinct accents, as I'm doing right now with my accent. Will, like language, to continue borrowing from St. Maximus' example, is highly idiomatic as much as it is hypostatic. No one doubts that the capacity to speak is endowed by nature, yet paradoxically, a nature that is not enhypostasized in the human person is mute. Neither the Genithito of the Lord's Prayer nor the Maranatha of the Church is or can be uttered by nature. In the great conversation between God and humanity that began with the world's creation and will continue in the epectasis of the ages to come, only persons can be partakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Father, for your presentation. Our second speaker is George Varvatsoulias, who is a psychologist working with asylum seekers as well as with clients suffering from depression, OCD, and psychopathology issues resulting from religious concerns. As Varvatsoulias, tell us about ruminative thinking and psychopathology issues in the writings of Saint Maximus the Confessor.
The actual presentation which I have made, it's actually an empirical research with a sample of participants in the subject of rumination, whether it has to do with psychopathology issues under the prism of evolutionary psychological perspectives, and certainly based on some of the writings of St. Maximus the Confessor. In evolutionary psychology, the aspect of rumination refers to the intense thinking about aims an individual has to fulfill, such as adaptation objectives, intense recollection of memories an individual had suffered from, and we call it reduced fitness maximization, intense and inactive focus on unhelpful emotions an individual feels unable to deal with, and we mean psychopathology issues. In St. Maximus the Confessor's psychological anthropology, rumination is understood as the reiterative attitude of thoughts bearing psychopathological content. In his question 15 to Thalassius, St. Maximus refers to rumination as regurgitation, whereby passions reveal their malevolent disposition and presence in the mind in terms of recurrent thinking. And he says, ως εν μυρικισμό της περιταπάθη κακής διαθέσεως. In the same extract, recurrent thinking is in the mind is maintained through το καρτερικόν και φιλόπονον και γεωργικόν και ίον αναδοτικόν και επινοητικόν, i.e. constancy, painstakingness, cultivation and indeed digestion and conceptual regeneration of negative appraisals. Recurrent thinking in St. Maximus' psychological anthropology is expressed with infinitives and past participles, such as περιποιήσαστε, συντηρούμενον, τυπούστε, to be self-preserved, in being maintained, to be represented. As these types indicate that recurrent thinking is conceptually conveyed in terms of reactions preserved through the law of passions and maintained as natural facts, και των μεν νόμων των παθών περιποιήσαστε τις φυσικές συντηρούμενων ενεργίες, in the Our Father, as well as in terms of sorrows represented in the mind, λυπηρών τυπούστε τον νουν, in the Our Father's, in the Our Father text 258. According to the literature, rumination evolutionary psychology is explained as a stochastic coping strategy, helping people control problems they feel unable to find answers. It is argued that individuals who ruminate are able to come to terms with issues at hand, even though solutions to adaptive problems haven't been selected for, such as setting up goals and be reminded of their lack of progress. Rumination can also be demonstrated as a social phenomenon as to the implication of the problem to other members of the society, so solutions to be endeavored collectively. In this paper, there will be conducted a study whether intense rumination can help individuals face issues of personal psychopathology. Next to the original hypothesis, there will be also hypothesized that the more individuals ruminate, the more matters of psychopathology are difficult to be dealt with. Many times in life, rumination takes place in relation to what people think that others have done or behaved against them. There are people who ruminate about others' behaviors unto themselves, though real or imagined. If such rumination becomes part of one's everyday thinking and emotional reactions, then it means that the memory of what took place can lead the individual mind to demonstrate in one's thinking what has been represented, i.e. tipuste, in the mind, with regards to what one feels that brought about sorrow to oneself, τον λυπηρών, due to the memories which reacted, reached, τον φθασάντον, one's mind. If such rumination persists, then one's opinion, recollection, and knowledge of others becomes divided both in terms of how one positions oneself before others and his/her understanding of the role of physical in reality appearance on things, the way these are personally comprehended. Saint Maximus' position of mirikismos, rumination, which actually mirikismos, rumination is coming from the Greek, from this Greek word mirikismos, has to do not only with negative and persistent thinking and rethinking, but with the faculties of the psyche as well. The so-called trichotomy or tripartite aspect of the psyche is argued to be the field where rumination takes place. The three aspects of the logistikon, or the uniqueness of the personal, το λογιστικόν, explained otherwise as the inner principle, the incentive, το θυμικόν, and the appetitive, το επιθυμητικόν, are actually related to ruminative thinking, whether directly via the relationship between λογιστικόν and θυμικόν, or indirectly, επιθυμητικόν, via thinking, λογιστικόν, and interpretation of thoughts, or the representation of them in mind, θυμικόν, or the feelings and emotions, including physical sensations such as tiredness, butterflies in the stomach, ulcers, etc., as well as grief, fear, worry, distress, anxiety may come out of them. In evolutionary psychology, ruminative thinking refers to the extensive appraisal of thoughts which our ancestors were bombarded by during the EEA, the environment of evolutionary adaptedness, where the human brain is believed to have had the neocortex capacity we have today when they were facing adapted challenges. If I could explain this a bit further. When we say the neocortex capacity, we mean actually the gray matter which covers 80% of our brain. And this is believed to... We have the same brain capacity, i.e. 80% of this gray matter, for the last 40,000 years, which is the Homo sapiens period. Adaptive challenges during the EEA had to do with collection and accumulation of food, arms race between conspecifics, settling in communities, avoiding and or handling dangers and physical disasters, protection issues, satisfaction of reproduction needs, communication issues with others, managing out resources and sharing them according to one another's need, meeting expectations during everyday necessities. Another aspect to be discussed below that relates to ruminative thinking is the challenge of adaptive problems to human behavior in terms of fitness issues. though fitness as an evolutionary term refers to successful reproduction rates, it does also include aspects of beneficial or costly gains in terms of societal relationships. In view to understanding the latter, we need to point out that beneficial and or costly gains explain the concept of fitness in association to overthinking processes by virtue of hostile environments. In reference to hostile environments is used, the reference to hostile environment is used not necessarily in the context of dangerous or life-threatening situations or events, but also in the context of unforeseen circumstances of or psychological reactions before incidents and events having been taken into account or preconceived by the human mind. The rationale and hypothesis to my study. In the present paper, as I say, presentation, what is presented and discussed is the relation between ruminative thinking and psychopathology. A special mention has been offered to the relationship between rumination and depression. It is evidence-based that ruminative thinking affects psychopathological experiences through the realm of thoughts and emotions. The hypothesis to be tested will be the more individuals ruminate, the more irrational thinking can lead to psychopathology. I had altogether 40 participants who were respondents recruited were Greek Orthodox regular churchgoers. 17 of them were males and 23 females. For the measures that I have used, I mean for the tools that I have used, it is on the one hand the response styles questionnaire by Nolan Hexema in 1987 consisted of 71 items, but I broke it down to 10 because it would be very tiring for participants to answer statements which are so many. And the self-devised questionnaire composed of St. Maximus references to ruminative thinking entitled Rumination and the Wakefulness of the Mind Inventory and consisted of 10 items. That inventory was created from statements, examples provided by St. Maximus the Confessor, in his question in his work on Thalassius. Well, now there is some statistical jargon. What I have to say for this, for the results is what I have found is that according to the sample that I have had is that men ruminate less compared to women. And when I say ruminate less, I mean either positively or negatively. Even when correlation was found to be not significant, actually what we can say is that it indicates that the relationship between men and women could arose by chance 60%. However, by knowing from literature that positive rumination is a helpful process for individuals, positive rumination, not negative rumination, it means that the research hypothesis that men ruminate positively had been rejected because, in fact, it is true. Again, for the correlation between men and negative rumination was also found not significant for the same reason, because we again know from the literature that negative rumination isn't a helpful process for individuals, which means that the research hypothesis that men ruminate negatively has been again rejected because, again, it is true, according to what literature and previous studies have found. The correlation between women and positive rumination was found significant, which means there would be only a 6% chance of finding a difference as the one observed in the study, i.e. 90% the correlation, if that study was to be replicated, probably would find the same results. To have an overview of the findings, the hypothesis of the present study is being supported in the light of significant association that was found between ruminative thinking and psychopathology. In detail, the present hypothesis is supported both in terms of positive and negative rumination. Individuals do ruminate positively and negatively in life, and the way that ruminative thinking appears applicable both to men and women. What I indicate by that is that positive and negative rumination is an everyday reality for both genders. In St. Maximus the Confessor's Psychological Anthropology, the elements of negative cognition and unhelpful emotional reactions are more than evident. In his writings, what he does most is to delve into the very depths of the human psychosomatic reality, either in the form of questions and answers, as in his Thalassius work, the second inventory comes from, or in the form of lengthy discussions he holds about theological and anthropological matters. What this study also supports is St. Maximus' consideration of human nature in terms of intrusive thoughts, the way these are presented through rumination, Mirikismos. Rumination is a decisive thinking process which, whether in terms of repetition or exaggeration, influences individuals' understanding of events, especially when these have a negative outcome. Ruminative thinking in St. Maximus is an important cognitive process. It is like the calf that is molten, indicating the mingling and mixing up of the natural powers of the soul with one another. Also, such mingling and mixing up is an impassioned and irrational companion, as well as an irrational consequence that effectuates passions against human nature. The calf is one, which means that the habit of an evil is being scattered into many sorts of evil. The calf, on the other, is enduring, industrious, cultivating, and indeed digestive and thoughtful, just like ruminating about the evil disposition that is related to passions. It is also molten, the calf, for what is being left in mind from the evil imagination constitutes the habit and energy of passions. As to the your gods, when he refers to when Moses delayed to come down from Mount Sinai, the Israelites ask Aaron to produce for them a molten calf. And then he says, as to your gods, because Aaron said, bring me your gods. As to your gods, Israel, St. Maximus, which has been said in plural, is due to the evil existing scattering nature that never stands still and is multiform and fragmenting. For if good is naturally uniting and bringing together what has been fragmented, the evil is fragmenting and corrupting what has been united, says St. Maximus. To my understanding, the above extract culminates St. Maximus the Confessor's psychology on ruminative thinking, and it is in concert to the findings of the present study. That is to say that ruminative thinking is an obstacle and burden to the mind, as well as a process which doesn't beget helpful appraisals. Ruminative thinking is mainly negative in context, for it creates problematic preoccupation with interpretations that do not assist psycho-spiritual balance in man. And ruminative thinking is a confusing and irrational experience which holds the human mind from selecting constructive and creative choices in life. I will go to the future application of this study. In a similar study, which I could do, could be to compose another inventory about ruminative thinking by incorporating more statements from St. Maximus' work of questions to Thalassius, so that to study not only rumination, but what is also associated to it, such as avoidant behaviors resulting from events, cognitive analysis, and negative consequences of antecedents, functional analysis. A title that I could give to such an inventory could be the Thinking and Acting Response Inventory, Statements on the Psychology of Human Mind, taken from St. Maximus the Confessor's work of Questions to Thalassius. In this way, I could examine St. Maximus' writings to Questions to Thalassius in terms of cognitive behavioral therapy methodology, and how the latter could be improved in taking into account St. Maximus' psychological anthropology with regards to cognitive and functional elements haven't been touched upon by this methodology. Such an academic endeavor could explore more St. Maximus' writings, as well as in reference to what St. Maximus has further to offer in relation to the understanding of the psychology of human mind. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Thank you, Mr. Varvatsoulias, for your unusual but interesting presentation. Our last speaker, In the fourth session is Father Philip Gabriel Ranchez, who's an assistant professor in systematic theology at the Gregorian University in Rome, as well as professor in historical theology at the Pontifical Institute Augustinianum, also in Rome. And he will speak about the concept of habitus in theological anthropology of Saint Maximus. Father.
Please allow me also to start my presentation with thanking Bishop Maxim and the organizers of this symposium to be part of this, as coming from all these pontifical institutions, I feel that there's a special significance or color also in my being here, which I'm very grateful for your generosity and easiness to have me with you. In order to make my talk a little bit more symphonic, so more to harmonize with the other talks we've had so far, I decided to modify it slightly. It will be a harder task for the translators, but I think to a greater enjoyment of all of us here. The title, you've just heard it, the title of my talk is, it was suggested as such to me, The Concept of Habitus in Theological Anthropology of St. Maximus the Confessor. And I think this title deserves two premises. The first is regards theological anthropology. It is implied by this title that the significance of the concept of hexes, I would rather say, than habitus, but on that I will talk in a minute. But so it is implied that the significance of this concept, habitus, lies in theological anthropology. Now, theological anthropology is certainly an anachronism with regard to Maximus, with regards to the fathers of the church, and I personally am not so happy with this concept, which was coined basically in the 40s of last century, at least in Western theology. I'm not so happy about it because it somehow seems to imply that there can be an essential reference to a theological discipline which puts man in the middle, and theological becomes the apposition, somehow an accidental that qualifies then the essence that is there. I would like thereby to clarify what I mean by theological anthropology. For me, ultimately, theological anthropology is really that what economia for the fathers meant. And how do we translate economia in a contemporary context? I would say it is really the conditions, reflect on the conditions of the possibility of a divine human relationship, or rather divine human interaction. And from an anthropological point of view, that means to do a theological anthropology is to ask the question, what is the sense of it all? And in particular, what is the sense of the history of salvation, which is dilated into stages, implying creation, implying the covenant or the covenants, leading to Jesus Christ coming, which ultimately, we've heard it just before, ultimately realized in the eschaton, in the divinization of man. What is the sense of this setting out of this relationship between God and human beings? As set out, which allows, and now we come to a specific problematic that involves the term of hexis or the term of habitus, which allows a sort of, if you wish, change or a sort of evolution. It is simply not true to say that creation and divinization is the same thing, that the covenant with Abraham is the same thing as the new covenant in Jesus Christ. So what is the meaning of that change, of that transformation that is happening in the relationship between God and human beings? That is the question that stays at the center of the question to ask what is the meaning of habitus for Maximus the Confessor. Divinization or deification means a transformation of human being set out in time. And of course, this is a concept that is at risk. It's a concept that is certainly based on Holy Scripture, but is also traceable in Orphism, in Platonism, Stoicism, in Neoplatonism. Divinization easily lends to a compromising understanding that may blur or level the radical ontological difference between God and human beings, leading to all sorts of pantheistic variations of thought. And it is in the light of this that now the term hexis assumes a very, I would say, theophilosophical significance in the thought of Maximus the Confessor and, let's say, in a theological anthropology in general. That was the first premise. The second one will be a little bit shorter, but that is the difficulty of how to render, how to translate the term hexis in modern languages. Because hexis, in its Greek significance, contains two senses, which we should always keep in mind, because it's in this interplay of those two meanings that this term becomes, in my view at least, so fruitful, so important for Maximus the Confessor. And the two senses are, first of all, we may call it an ontological sense, the intransitive sense of hexis, which relates to a state of being. So hexis always means a certain configuration, a stable disposition of being, which is dynamic as being, of course, is dynamic. So we have a very dynamic significance of hexis, maybe to be translated as simple as state and thinking of a state of being. The second meaning, equally important, refers to hexis as the noun, substantivation of the verb echein, and there, so as echein can an intransitive and a transitive sense, now referring to this transitive sense, and then it means something that is acquired. So hexis meaning a possession we have. And we see that immediately. It is very interesting how that dynamic sense of hexis in a way of being is then correlated to a more punctual, a more definitive sense of having acquired something, something that I dispose of, a disposition that I have, a possession. Both of these meanings now become very important for Maximus the Confessor when indeed he places hexis in his works in a position that cannot be qualified anymore as marginal, but it is at the very center of his reflections of God and human beings can be in this relationship that is a living relationship. There is, first of all, a philosophical sense that comes, especially is then inherited by Maximus the Confessor, from a philosophical meaning or understanding of hexes that was already around in his time, that basically goes back to Aristotle, has certainly been then transmitted through generations also to the Neoplatonic, especially the Neoplatonic philosophy. In there, hexes is very similar to what we usually refer to as virtue. That is to say, a disposition or a habit. Now, I introduce at this point this possible translation of hexes as habit, which has problems in itself, that because the problem is that it is too close to what we call a custom, so something that is acquired through a regular practice. Hexes is in Aristotle and is for Maximus more than that. It is something that is always referring to a free expression of free will, and not something that, like a habit, as more as we do it, it simply seems to indicate that our freedom, the portion of our freedom, diminishes in itself. And it is for that particular reason that in the end, I think that a possible good translation for hexes is indeed habitus rather than habit, because with this exotic flavor that habitus still contains in our modern languages, it keeps the conscience awake that it is not simply customary, habitual habit that what hexes implies. And that now within brackets, by that there is of course a certain similitude, a certain similarity with the use of habitus in scholastic Thomistic theology, which when it comes to point out that habitus is indeed always pointing to the free exercise of human being and not more and more an automatic, a mechanical exercise of our will and our operation, there is something true. At the same time, where this habitus in Thomistic theology immediately implies, more or less explicitly implies, to the distinction between created and uncreated grace, meaning that habitual habitus grace is pointing to the sanctifying grace or only the created grace, that is something that is not present in Maximus at all. So if we say habitus for hexes, we should be aware that there is a limit to, or at least an awareness that we at the same time should convey when using the term. The philosophical meaning of hexes as, like virtue, orienting our decision process, let me call it like this for a moment. So the formation of our will is just like, indeed, like the term of virtue as it is used in Aristotle. In Maximus, since we are talking here about what I said, theoanthropology, this is immediately opened up to an understanding where personhood, analogy, and relationship assume new levels of significance, which we cannot find as such in Aristotelian philosophy. There's a theological meaning of hexes, and that is now something at least very typical of theological anthropology, of grace theology, and that is to tackle the question of the possibility of human agency in the light of human divinization. We know, we've heard it several times already during also here this Congress, that divinization in itself, there is no natural capacity, there's no natural faculty that would allow for divinization. Maximus uses exactly this term hexis to point out how human nature can truly cooperate, can truly be active in this process of divinization, which is entirely God's enterprise, God's endeavor. In his analysis of the human act, object of the confessor's interest in the battle, especially against monoenergism and even so more so in against monothelitism, when Maximus is confronted with the task to give an account on the faculties of human beings in the light of divine action to respond to God's gifts, Maximus emphasizes the importance for human beings of this instance that is created, is built within humans, I'm sorry, that is called this hexis, this disposition. Hexis undoubtedly thereby regards a moral sense. It regards that what is the well-being suspended or in between the being and the forever being. And it is at this point, at the first, let's say, as a first step, that we can see now what Maximus means when he uses the term hexis. It means there what is the formation of our being expressed in wills and actions. It will then be this positive fixation of what the gnome has as instable of the gnome. We've seen it several times again, it's here, what the gnome presents as a factor, as a reality of instability, of variations, variety, that is against the divine telos, the divine project to make man godlike forever. Divinization in this respect is really the opposite of what happens with, let's say, the original account of the possibility of falling away of the divine state. This is really what divinization is not about. It means to be forever stably fixed in this process of being divinized. Who received a change regarding his flesh at the level of his faculty of judgment? This is my translation of what Maximus calls here, who receives a gnomic change regarding his flesh through the perfect circumcision of all natural movements, is thereby clearly showing to become God by grace, being in his action beyond the matter according to the flesh, and in his thought beyond the form according to the mind, out of which matter and form the existence of beings are constituted. The divinized constitutes himself, and to say it all, becomes, according to a hexis of virtual knowledge, totally immaterial and formless, thanks to God Logos, who became for us truly one of us in matter and form, being in his nature immaterial and without form in a superior way. This is Ambigua 30. And you have all the themes that I announced at the beginning, this somehow this superposition of the eternal and the temporal, so this God-human interaction that is somehow all incarnated in Christ, but from Christ reaching out to touch human beings in all times. A special interest is reserved to the observation that God's gift in form of hexes will have to fix the situation of instability in which human beings under the influence of sinfulness profoundly marking mankind since the day sin entered the world find themselves. Being drawn, we heard this, to a sheer endless variety of options and finding it next to impossible to find the golden means, this Aristotelian golden means of virtue, between the too much and the too little, decisions become a very intricate and complex task, and keeping focused in life becomes a crushing charge. The problem ultimately does not lie outside but inside, where every human being is confronted with the fact that the faculty of assuming one's freedom as a fundamental characteristic of one's own existence is seriously compromised with regard to both personal judgment and personal will, either of them instances of the human persons that in Maximus Greek are expressed by this famous word, gnomi. Now, so we heard this, gnomi means basically two things, if we want to summarize all these more than 30 meanings of gnomi. On the one hand, it means this faculty, human faculty to design my personal life. It's a way, it's a configuration of my personal life in this existential sense. And on the other side, gnomi already characterizes the precariousness, the instability with which all of us operate to do exactly that job, that is to design, to give a personal input to our lives. And here I would like just to add my 5-cent thought why Maximus doesn't permit a gnomic will in Jesus Christ. And I would like just, let's say, to complete the picture. I have the impression that what has come out so far is very much that, well, he doesn't allow for gnomi, but he certainly, Maximus, would go along with admitting a gnomic will in Jesus Christ. I would like to say I would prefer being more faithful to Maximus, really putting this stop and say, no, there is no gnomi in Christ, so not a deliberative will, if we want to translate gnomi by that, because just to being to honor Maximus in this. But I would like to point out that really the point is this. There is, of course, there is a dynamics, which is a dynamic in all human beings. And according to Maximus, it's always threefold. It's not between two terms, but it's a three-polar thing. And that would be ousia, dynamis, energia. And in this passage, there is the gnome that orients this dynamization of, let's say, of a will that is on an ousia, which is of course already a dynamis and thereby an hopetized ousia, so it's not just an abstract ousia, but it's a personified ousia. But this passage from ousia towards to energia is oriented, is directed by the gnome, and this gnome is sinful, and therefore there cannot be in Jesus Christ a gnome. What Christ has is the passage, is this dynamicity, it's this dynamics going from ousia towards energia, which can maybe better expressed by what the term hexis really says. It is a fixation of the gnome. And in Christ, this fixation is the obedience to the Father. So this is there, what is in Christ, but there is no gnomic will, even though, and this is now something we really should have in mind, even though there is a change, an apparent change in Christ's human will. And this is happening to the eyes of everyone now and reading scripture with the Garden of Gethsemane. There is Christ's human nature that says, please, no chalice, and then says, I take the chalice. And this change is expressed without a gnome. It is expressed through the act, let's say, the virtue of obedience, which is the replacement of the gnome, of the human gnome, because it's always there. The Son in his human nature concurs to doing the will of the Father. There is no tricking around, no moment of taking a distance from the Father's will. I think I have my time is up. Is that correct? Let me just point out to finish this all. I was asked also to talk a bit about the modern or the contemporary meaning of hexes in Maximus. And let me say something here that I find interesting also with respect to this sort of approximation of Maximus' thought with a virtue philosophy. The personalized way of a stabilized will of divinization through the formation of hexes. It is Christ's hexes that he, through this kenotic act, according to Maximus, imprints on us. This is really happening, and in this act of grace that our gnome will be stabilized, will be fixed into becoming that virtue that Christ is, doing the will of the Father, takes indeed its cues from the way will was formed in Jesus, in the human nature of Jesus Christ. In particular, the analysis of the decisive choice of Jesus in the drama of Gethsemane was subjected to a process of readjustment of his will to the mission given to him, shows, and this is now one way of seeing the importance of hexes in a modern context, that the capital question, what should I do? So the second of the three questions, according to Kant, sum up the whole philosophy. This question bears features that cannot find an adequate response outside the intimate relationship with God, and that is what Maximus teaches us. Exactly expressed in the prayer, you will be done. Jesus manifests that the discernment effected in the Garden of Gethsemane led him to recognize the divine will addressed to him personally, a message indeed delivered just as the angel that approached him from heaven. It is as if the angel really suggested, we could say, suggested this adjustment. Although the very decision that Jesus was confronted with, without any doubt, a singular case, not transferable as such to the type of conflict that man commonly meets in life, still it is revelatory of the phenomena that every life of a believer is set in front of choices that go beyond the merely ethical, though certainly tied to the ethical, as they are not due to the simple moral choice between good and evil. On this category of decisions, all the choices that concern the profession to exercise, the state of life, the investment, for instance, of large sums, the reference to this area of decision-making, which in the light of God, it indeed assumes the right or wrong, but on an anthropological level, no one can answer to me if I'm supposed to live a celibacy life or I'm supposed to marry, what is God's will. So it is that level indeed that ultimately the hexes touch in our gnome. It is very important that we keep in mind, and that is that all the virtues, in Thomistic theology at least, but let's say in general, all the Christian virtues, they always lead back to Jesus Christ. So it's not the main distinction is not to be made between cardinal virtues and theological virtues, but all of these virtues are characterized by a Christian, meaning like a Christ-like way of realizing them. And it's thereby that really only also the evangelical councils, the Beatitudes, get their true meaning. It's only in this context that we really can learn God's will for us in a moral theology. Hexis is a disposition acquired in this relationship with God. It includes a spiritual discernment based on a very personal calling that solicits the pursuit of a profound consistency of one's being together with one's personal potencies and one's personal actions. It is indeed a freedom for this gnome that indeed becomes truly godlike. It is said, says Maximus, and with that I finish, that God and man are examples for one another, and that God becomes human in his love for the man as much as man, empowered by God, becomes divine love. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Father Philip. We can now proceed to the question and answer session, to the exchange of opinions. The floor is open for your questions as well as remarks.
I would like to thank for the...
Thank you. Thank you, speakers all. The question I have, I direct to Father Philip. I'm not sure if you can answer this from Maximus, but I think it's an important question in relation to Christ in the garden and the question of the stability of Christ's will in the good. What is the meaning of temptation for someone whose will is fixed and stable in the good? Because I ask this because temptation for us, I suppose, characteristically means the possibility of a failure. Temptation only is intelligible in terms of a possibility of failure. So what is temptation for Christ if he has a stable fixation upon the good?
Thank you very much for this question. I think the following. So everything Christ does, he does for us. It has an economic significance. So if Christ is tempted and overcomes the temptation, it is for us, okay? And so it is a bit like asking why was Christ expressing already, let's say, this first human will of not accepting the chalice. That is, he did this for us, okay? There is, of course, then indeed to be learned that within temptation, there is a beginning of temptation. There's a very root of temptation which lies outside already a moral evaluation of the temptation as such. And that is, in fact, we know this for sure because Christ had temptations, he who was without sin. And that is extremely important, of course, for everyone, like each of us, who experiences temptations. So a wrong moralization of that is to be excluded. At the same time, it shows with Christ's temptation, I mean, the story doesn't end there that he's tempted, but the story is that he overcomes the temptation. And we are taken into this dynamic. So this is the meaning, the true meaning, in the resurrection is the purpose of all to be found. In the overcoming of the temptations, the meaning of temptations is to be found. The true possibility of human beings really capable of overcoming temptations, so really being divinized in a cooperative way by also overcoming temptations, not just passively waiting for some grace to come down. That is the meaning of Christ's temptations.
Right.
I would like to thank the speakers for very rich presentations, and I have some questions for Father Manousakis. First of all, I would like to ask your opinion if the concept of gnome would of Max the Maximian concept of gnomi could lead to a fruitful dialogue with the philosophical current of phenomenology, because if phenomenology is a philosophy from the perspective of the finite being that is thrown into the world, then maybe the term of gnomi would be very fruitful to develop in such a way. Secondly, I would like to ask, it seems that we have three questions in Maximus, like what, who, and how. And I would like to ask if the answer to what is, of course, the nature or essence, but I would like to ask if the questions who and how have the same response, which is the hypostasis, or if they have different response, like one being the hypostasis and the other being a mode that would be both different from hypostasis and from nature. So if we have three questions. Thirdly, I would like to ask if we could formulate the drama of Gethsemane. There is a very rich bibliography as a dilemma, as a struggle or a peripeteia, either between a natural appetite and a rational volition, or a human will and a divine will. And I would like to ask you how we could integrate all that to the, as you said, to the thelon, to the hypostasis that wills, which would mean a certain Cappadocian lecture of Maximus. And finally, I would like to make the remark that even though it is very important to insist, as you have done, on the personal difference in eschatology, I have the impression that this is not articulated so much with the term of gnomi, as we have an ekhorsis gnomiki in eschata, but we have other. It is more with the term of tropos, and we have expressions like tropos to efine και to fefine. We have the expression analogos, analogi tropi. We have a difference between methexis and epignosis that is highlighted by His Eminence, the Bishop of Pergamon, and also by Polycarp Sherwood. And I would like to ask that if in this eschatological theology of Maximus that we have this difference between methexis and epignosis, if we could see this, if we could see that in a dialogue with Heidegger's philosophy that speaks of a certain ontological stance or stance towards being, because it seems that a certain tropos in the eschata is a tropos towards the event of the common resurrection of nature.
Well, thank you very much, Dionysi. Several questions, all of them very good. They will probably require another paper in order to do justice to them. I will try to answer them one by one, and if I forget any, please remind me. On the question of what utility or usefulness phenomenology may have in this discussion, I think, and that is what I've been trying to do in my work, is to utilize the resources of phenomenology in retrieving the texts and, you know, the meaning in these classical texts, such as the patristic texts, but also ancient texts, and try to make sense of them, trying to, you know, make sense of them for today, so to speak. There is, there was a great deal in my paper that was informed by a certain understanding of phenomenology, especially the references to consciousness and how this can hardly be justified, how the absence of consciousness can hardly be justified eschatologically, if we're still to speak of the created nature and indeed of a human being. Therefore, that relates also to your last point about Heidegger, who opens the horizon of the ontological difference between being and beings. Only in my case, and I think this is the spirit, at least, of the fathers, they will have preferred the inversion of Heidegger's schema, because for Heidegger you begin with being, particular being, Dasein, in order to eventually reach being in general, Sein. While I think the whole point of this discussion is how can we move away from the anonymity of nature, as I call it, the anonymous existence, what Levinas, for example, calls the Ilia, back to personal existence, which again Levinas in his early work calls hypostatic existence. It's very telling that he's using this very term, which has been so much discussed in this conference and in the works of the fathers. So I think the texts of St. Maximus, as other patristic texts, certainly invite a reading that comes informed by phenomenology. And one will find surprising observations and conclusions at the end of such an exercise. Now to the question, if I remember correctly, about the difference between the what, the how, and the who. There are four questions when it comes to the will. There is the capacity of the will as power, as dynamis, as faculty. And then there is the object of the will, the what, το θελητόν, το ρεκτόν, το επιθυμητόν. There's a long terminology on this, from Aristotle all the way, from Plato, in fact, all the way to St. Maximus, if we want to stop in the thinker with which we have been dealing the last days. So this is the object of will, and those two are determined by nature. And then there is the who and the how, which of course refer to the person, to the one who wills, to a thelon. The how indicates indeed the way, the tropos της ύπαρξεως, but this is because each one of us actualizes the common capacity of the will differently. That's why at the end, the way that I conceptualized the question that I was trying to present in my paper was basically the balance, or what I call the dialectic relationship between the communion of nature and the otherness, the idiosyncrasy, if you wish, the idiomatic hypostasis of the person. Was it anything that I forgot? Was there any other point that you raised? I believe in the many ways, as you said, and there's a large literature on this particular episode. Some very interesting and surprising, like the idea of deception, of which Father Maximus has written. In other words, that one way to see it, that Christ is not experiencing a moment of fear or cowardness, but actually he's putting up a play of deception to deceive the evil one, to believe that he is a human up to the last moment or minute before his divinity functions as the bait in which devil is caught. But I will personally subscribe to the idea of a harmonization. It's the moment that the divine will and the human will in the single hypostasis of Christ become harmonized, and it's kind of a history turning point. After that, it's only a question of time until each one of us come to say the same thing. Yet not as I want, but as you want.
Father Maximus.
Just for Father Philip, am I audible? Yeah. First of all, thank you very much for that lucid and wonderful analysis of the word and concept of exis in Maximus. I have a very simple question. You repeatedly translated the word exis as theophysis, I mean, among other renderings, but theophysis had a tendency to push itself, I'm sorry, disposition. He translated exis repeatedly as disposition, which is perfectly fine, but that's also the way theophysis is traditionally rendered. And I know the two terms, theophysis and exis, are very closely related in Maximus. So if you could, I would like you to maybe say something about theophysis, how it relates to exis and how it differs from exis.
When it comes to, it's true that I like that dimension of hexes in this almost cognitive, or let's say, theoretical orientation function that it has in order to push or stimulate our moving towards this or that direction that eventually leads to a certain option. I do think in order to keep this dynamicity alive, the word disposition is maybe not a bad one. At the same time, you're absolutely right that the Greek disposes of the other term, and in that sense, hexis indeed expresses a much greater stability. That is already Aristotle who pointed out that our dispositions can so easily change and vary, whereas then the hexis is already this stabilization, or it expresses already a stabilized phase or stage where our dispositions have then be conformed to a certain way of being. That is then, let's say, in my class, I always give this example that certainly Mother Teresa of Calcutta, at the end of the days, she didn't have to think for a long time if she were to help a poor that she would meet in the street or not, because she had developed then this stable disposition, this habitus. So that would be then not anymore a good translation disposition for hexis. Hexis indeed means already this virtue that is with us, that in some ways the scholastics wanted to say it becomes like a second nature, that we have assumed, we have adopted, we have formed in us through regular practice of specific actions. So there is, again, when it comes to this very fine theoretical function that hexis has, and to my mind it always has, and that expresses very well the connection to gnome, because this is really what gnome does. Then disposition, maybe it's also induced by the German, that German Haltung is a very good, fine word for that. So that would justify maybe the translation disposition. From a different angle, from a different point of view, disposition becomes far too a weak rendering of hexis.
The relationship of the diathesis to hexis, though?
Yeah, that would be, the diathesis is basically what we have. It's almost, it's a faculty that is given to us with our nature, that is to say, to move in time not blindly, not in a determined way, but in a way that we can then configure our way of being. So it would be this potency that we have in order then to make decisions, in order to configure, specifically configure our way of being. That would be the diathesis. And that is indeed, that is also then hexis, but hexis becomes then already a configured way which has been confirmed and reconfirmed by a person in his life.
Thank you. Next. If nobody wants to ask a question, I'll just make a comment. All right. Yeah.
So there's a debate about, an ongoing debate about the nomic will in Christ, according to Maximus, and we seem to have two defenses here today of that position. So I at least want to lift that up, and perhaps there's a consensus emerging of some sorts. Or perhaps there'll be a conference organized a few months to indicate the heresy of the positions that were indicated here. So, but I think that has to be at least lifted up in some sense, right? But, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot, Father Pandelima, but I don't know if you had a chance to read the appendix of David's paper. But there seem to be two different kinds of defenses of that, right? I mean, David was trying to indicate in some sense two different senses of Nomi and Maximus, and maybe I'm misdescribing the way you're doing it, Father Pandelima, but it seemed to be more of a phenomenology of the subjectivity. So I don't know if you know, again, I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but is there a way to connect these two defenses, but somewhat different approaches to affirmation of the of a nomic will, of some form of understanding of the nome to the person of Christ?
Thank you, Telly. I try carefully to stay away from the Christological question per se, and I was concerned mostly with the anthropological aspect of the question of the will, and especially, as I said at the beginning of the paper, of the eschatological destiny of the will. I'm interested to think whether a gnomic will or gnomi, especially to the to one of the two definitions that Professor Bradshaw brought up, the one that linked to gnomi with hypostasis, if that will be surviving at the eschata. And if not, for me the problem there is that we're dealing more or less with a sort of panentheism or the collapse of the person back to the anonymity of the human nature. And personally, I found that problematic. I have no problem with the fact, if this is the consensus that emerges, that Christ doesn't have a gnomic will, if by that we mean the second definition of Professor Bradshaw, which is the deliberation and the strangling will, as someone else put it earlier, between the apparent good and the good, or between good and evil. So if I think that's a very useful distinction, and it comes down, in fact, we need to kind of focus on whether Maximus, or what Maximus means really by the gnomic will, whether he means the one or the other or both at different times. And I mean, this is an important question. I think it is. It has been has emerged as one of the central questions of our discussion. So thank you, Telly.
Do we have another? Professor Tollefson?
Just two questions. The first one is, do you think that all nature, that is for Father John, I should say, of course, do you think that all nature is common? Because I think it's a bit more difficult than that. I think you also have to realize that there is a concept of particular nature. And if one reads the seventh book of the Aristotelian Metaphysics, chapters 7 to 9, you can see this there as well, compared with chapter 4, of course, which is notoriously difficult, but even so. And one thing more, I wonder, could you, maybe I missed something here, but could you please tell me, maybe I sound rather stupid now, but could you please tell me, is it indicated in this handout which I have that the felix culpa somehow related to the idea of consciousness is a part of the constitution of being a hypostasis or a human person? Thank you.
I would like to see when I speak to you. If I understand the question was whether I take consciousness to be a fundamental characteristic of the hypostasis, of the human hypostasis, I will say yes. For me, personally, I cannot imagine a human being basically without the concept of time, that's what I mean, and without the concept of, or the ability of self-reflection. That's why I took as an example that the case of shame, which is a phenomenon that implies consciousness, or it is an indication of consciousness, and especially self-consciousness, reflective consciousness. And that's why I find it problematic when we speak of man without the ability to feel shame or any other similar phenomenon, whether in the prelapsarian stage or in the eschatological perfection. I know that theologically that raises many questions, but I will have either to think through more or have a discussion, a lengthy discussion on the subject, that will leave me satisfied with the fears that the idea of an unconscious human being imply for me. I mean, I don't know what exactly that will be and what good will be to speak of salvation of such a human being, especially since it implies also the eradication of memory, in other words, the eradication of our identity. That's why I said at some point in my paper, it's the question of what is being saved ultimately when we speak of salvation. Even if we speak of particular nature, is it good enough for me? I don't want to bring again the easy accusation of Platonism, but it sounds something like the Platonic immortality of the soul, which is a cheap substitution for what man really longs for, which is personal identity, or the other alternative will be some kind of Eastern, some idea of an Eastern religious escape from the ego for the sake of become unified again in some nirvana. In a Buddhistic way, perhaps. I'm very skeptical of either of these two alternatives. And I think the idea of a God who is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob is a God of particular persons who are persons with a history and with a memory and with a consciousness and in time and space. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like just to mention one claim from Father John's presentation, asking what is saved. He answered, if God does not save the human person, but the human nature as a genus and as an abstraction there. He is not anymore the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, but a God of Platonic ideas. But for the sake of precision, I would like to say that the God of Platonic ideas does not save the human nature at all. Because if human nature is idea at all, and let's say for the sake of argument that it is, the God of Platonic ideas find it as eternal in front of him, and as eternal it has no need for salvation. So the God who saves human nature is not God of Platonic ideas. I mean, we don't find it only here, but I would say it's a common mistake we all made speaking about Platonic God.
Sure. You're absolutely correct. The absurdity of speaking of a God who say a Platonic God who saves human nature was meant precisely to show that this is not an alternative that our thought can take, that therefore it will have to be the first possibility. In other words, it has to be a God who saves a human person. Because to save the human nature, as very correctly said, is in a way a contradiction in terms. Nature as an idea, as an abstraction, doesn't need any saving. Right.
Thank you.
I would like to make a remark about memory and consciousness. There are some extracts of Maximus about eschatology where he speaks about the apokatastasis in relation to Gregory of Nyssa. And then he says that memory is purified by remembering evil.
Correct.
Or something like that. And I think that there is an alternative to either a personal consciousness or unconsciousness, which would be rather a common consciousness. No. But there is, however, yes.
No, Yanis. That would be also, in my view, that would be also a solution that will not be good enough. I'm aware of that passage where St. Maximus speaks of the eradication of the evil memory, but I take that to mean that from the perspective of the end of times, evil itself and the memory of evil, therefore, becomes transformed. And the best example that I can give of if something that happened to me in my childhood that was very painful at the moment, when I recall it now through the perspective of time, it's not painful anymore. It can be even entertaining. It can be something that I can laugh about. So I think all of the evils of history, seen from the perspective of the end of times, in other words, given enough time, they will assume a different meaning, and that will be not evil anymore. If evil is preserved, I see His Eminence Metropolitan Pergamon disagrees. But if evil memories are preserved, then evil has triumphed at the end.
So there would be a personal memory, but without pain.
Yes,
like that.
Yes, it would have been somehow transformed because it would be seen and lived and experienced. Because memory is an event of the present, of course. You remember in the present. It's not that you can somehow go back to the past. The consciousness doesn't function as a time machine that can take you to the past. So when you're thinking of your childhood now, it's a new event that's taking place now. And therefore, from the perspective of the end of time, I think we'll have a different view of this. And to me, it's the only redemption. This will be the only redemption of history. The other two alternatives will be to take very literally what St. Maximus means as an eradication of memory, and therefore an eradication of history, then we become somehow completely unconscious of what happened to us. But that will be also an eradication of the history that involved God,
that will be an eradication of God's intervention in the history of Israel in Exodus. That will be an eradication of his crucifixion, of his resurrection. I mean, how can you maintain that? The other alternative is that you remember all this. But if you remember all these as painful events, as when they happen, in the moment they happen, then, as I said, evil has won the game. A good example that will perhaps appease His Eminence in his initial disagreement is that we have the how we have the memory of the salvific history in the Divine Liturgy, in the Eucharist. We don't experience, we don't remember, as we say in the Anaphora, the tomb, the passion, the tomb, the resurrection, and even the second coming, as something painful, as it was perhaps experienced for the people who were eyewitness. But we experience it quite differently now, because we experience it eschatologically. But we remember it.
Yes? Wait for Mike.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Father John, the question that you pose at the very beginning of your paper, and that is, will or will not the creaturely character of the creature abide eschatologically, and then subsequently, does the created uncreated distinction still hold at the end of times and in God's kingdom? I'm trying to come up with a Christian theologian, whether sort of heretical, heterodox, orthodox or not, that would have ever actually, in his sane mind, obliterated that distinction in any sense whatsoever. And I'm coming up with Meister Eckhart, and that's about it. That's to say, even panentheists, precisely as entheos suggests, in fact, would not obliterate that distinction and would still uphold a sense in which the created eternally abides in the uncreated. They would certainly formulate the in very different ways, but any panentheist even would not obliterate that distinction ultimately altogether. Again, if we're talking about distinction, not some kind of ontological separation in this case, gradually. So I'm coming up with Meister Eckhart. I'm actually not coming up with anybody else, because even in Origen, for example, I'm not entirely sure that one could claim that the distinction is obliterated. So help me to understand, therefore, the force of the problem.
In other words, what informed that original question?
Well, yes. In other words, if no Christian thinker has ever, again, accepting perhaps Eckhart, and I'm not entirely sure how to understand Dionysius, by the way, on that particular point, but if no theologian has ever really answered the question in the affirmative, that is, that the distinction is obliterated, then what is then?
Thank you, first of all, for the question. The question was imposed itself on me as a result of that debate to which I refer at the beginning of my paper that is unfolding in Greece. In which the argument has been made that will is entirely a property of nature. And therefore, to me, it seems that one of the mistakes that this position entails is that eschatologically, one returns, so to speak, back to nature completely and has to lose his personal identity. Or becomes absorbed by nature, and it's that it is for this reason that I thought it was useful to remind ourselves of the distinction between created and uncreated, a distinction that since its formulation in the Oros of Chalcedon will have to be taken now as surviving and abiding even beyond the end of times. You are right that we don't have perhaps, with the exception perhaps of the expression in St. Paul that God will be all in all, and how one can read that. It's more of a question of interpretation. I will be willing to go as far as to accept an identity between identity and not identity, eschatologically. which sounds very close to describing a panentheistic view. But even that, as long as the distinction, however formally, is maintained, that will be good for me. That will satisfy me. But in the case that the eschatological vision, the deification of man, means that he's, and again, I don't have someone in, specific in mind, but if that is what it means, then I have a problem with that. Yeah.
Follow up very quickly that, I mean, I understand, of course, that it's plausible to claim that something would return to some pre-personal nature.
Correct.
But that, again, that would not entail an uncreated state. In other words, a non-personal nature could be a created non-personal nature.
If one were to take the notion of deification literally, that you become a god, then perhaps one might want to understand, and it's a caveat towards this understanding that I want to issue, that one might understand that the distinction between created and uncreated has been surpassed.
All right. Then we'll close our session, our discussion, and go to an early dinner so that we can be back at 6:30 sharp to start our fifth session. Thank you.
Okay.